Hello everyone, this is Pastor Blake, and we're continuing our study of the book of Daniel, chapter 7. Now we see through Daniel, you definitely need to make sure to read 7 before we go into this, but 1 through 6 really is a different kind of book when 7 starts, okay? 1 through 6 you see that there's stories. It's basically telling the stories of what's happening in the kingdom at the time, all of Daniel's adventures of kind of the besiegement, and then of the first dream, and then of the golden statue Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had to bow to, and they didn't, and then another dream, and then another vision, or the fingers writing on the wall, and Daniel's recording all of this that's happening, and then all of a sudden, chapter 7, it's like God takes his almost God takes his attention off the kings necessarily and puts it right on to Daniel to show Daniel some things that are happening in the kingdom and to show what is going to happen in the entire world. And some seem like it's future, some is a little bit of past, but it's very interesting what Daniel sees, and it even startles him. You see Daniel's a little bit different whenever he sees all of this. He's, you know, kind of shy around the kings, telling him the bad news that, you know, the kingdom will be overthrown and new kings and stuff. But Daniel himself, it says, is alarmed by these dreams, these visions. In verse 28, the very last verse, we're going to skip to that. It says, Daniel was greatly alarmed, and it says he kept the matter in his heart. So this is very different from what Daniel has seen so far. It was more to another person, and now Daniel's starting to see what's going to happen in the entire world. And it's so strange that I don't know. He doesn't know how to take it almost. So let's dive in today. When it starts off, Daniel, you know, has a dream, has a vision. And then the second, it says that he woke up and then he wrote all this down. And I encourage you, if you have a dream, if you have a vision, if even while in your prayer time, while you're reading your word time, I'd encourage you to always have a journal, something just to write down, not what you did today, you know, you had a burger and fries, no, nothing like that. But what is God speaking to you through your dreams or through your reading or your words and your prayer time? It's very important to do that, because then you'll be able to look back one day and you'll be able to see how God has taken you through different steps in his plan for you, and how you don't think the same way you used to. You think at a higher level and a higher level. And so I would encourage you to do that. It's very powerful. But in verse 2, and it says that four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea. So there's like this violentness to this dream or this vision. There's a rushing. There's a power to it. And so it kind of gets Daniel's attention. And then in verses 3 through 8, we see that there's four different beasts that are given. And Daniel was able to kind of describe them. And you can see it's like a lion. It's like a leopard. But he doesn't ever say it is something. It's like it. And so we always use this as a kind of an understanding. He's trying to show you the best that he can with what he can see and how he knows. Okay, so the first beast was like a lion and with eagle's wings. It had eagle's wings on its back. And but then all of a sudden the wings were plucked up and it stood up like a man. Pretty strange. But the beast number 2 was like a bear, and it was raised up on one side, it says, and it had 3 ribs within its mouth, and the bear was told to eat much flesh. It's getting a little bit stranger. The third beast was like a leopard. It had 4 wings like a bird on its back, but it also had 4 heads. Even stranger. And then the fourth beast, what's wild, is that it takes a deviant from the other three. The three were kind of like a lion, kind of like a leopard, kind of like a bear, but they had pretty much similarities. And this other one, it wasn't given an animal's similarity. It was just told it was terrifying. It was horrible. It had teeth and iron, like iron. It had horns on it. It devoured and broke into pieces things, left bones at its feet. It had 10 horns, and then one little horn came up. And when it came up, the little horn took over 3 other horns, and they were plucked up by their roots. And the little horn had like eyes like a man and a mouth. Okay, that's very strange. So this is a big difference from a statue that represented different kingdoms, at least it seems like. I mean, what does this mean? We're going to go back to it in just a little bit, so hang on. And then in verse 9, it says, we see an image of the heaven, in heaven, of the Ancient of Days, which we know as to be God. And the imagery that surrounded him, it says that clouds were his clothes were like white as snow, which we know represents purity. And his head was like pure wool, representing most likely his knowledge and his wisdom. And his throne was surrounded by thousands of thousands who served him. And we know it wasn't necessarily a countable number. It's more of like an expression, like there was a bazillion of them. Well, that's not really a number. It's more just a reference. There was so many that he couldn't even count. He couldn't have even the time to count it. It was just thousand upon thousands. And it says that his throne was like a fiery flame, and his wheels were like a fire, and we know like chariots coming to judge and coming like a king rolling in to somewhere important and stuff. And so we see these images, and so all of this is kind of things that Daniel's trying to help us understand what he's seeing, but the whole time he's alarmed. He's just trying to kind of hold it together to write all this down. And so in verses 11 and 12, we see the beast was killed, the fourth beast we're talking about. The beast was killed and its body destroyed by fire. And the other beasts' dominions were taken away, but their lives were prolonged. And the Son of Man represents Jesus, and how he was given all of authority. His dominion will never pass away and shall not be destroyed. In verses 15 and 16, Daniel was shooken up by this vision, and he went up and asked someone who stood there. Now, we don't know who this person was, but during the vision, Daniel went up to some person of some sort and asked, like, what is going on here? What is happening with all these beasts and all of the kingdoms and the horns and mouths and eyes and stuff? What is happening? And it talks about how in verses 17, 18, that the four beasts are the four kings who shall rise on the earth, but the saints of the Most High shall prevail and possess the kingdom forever. Okay? That's actually the significant part here. But we go on, Daniel 19 and 22. Daniel repeats, what he saw in order to ask what the four beasts meant. He's like, I saw this beast with the horns, and the horn came up and it overtook three other horns. What does all this mean? And in verse 23 through 27, the fourth beast represents a kingdom that will take over the entire earth. And the ten horns are 10 different kings that will come from it. But the little horn will be someone specific that will grow to the point it will take over three of the other 10 kings. And whoever this is, this king will speak against God and war against the saints, and also will change the times and the law, and they shall be given into his hand for the time, times, and time and a half. So we know that the time. It says change the times could mean the calendar, could mean the way we perceive it. The law means actually kind of what it says. It seems like the law of the lands will change because of this king that will happen. It does not like God and it wars against the saints. So it definitely has this apocalyptic kind of revelations feel to it. But we can't jump to any conclusions. We can look at it further. But in verse 26, it says, eventually this king shall be taken down and his power taken from him. You see, there's a repeating in Daniel already. We're going to see it, and it's going to lead up to the very last point. But there's all these powers that will come up in the earth, but the kingdom of God shall take over, and it shall reign. We see this continuously repeated in Daniel. So that's kind of more the significant point here, okay? And verse 27, the kingdom will be given to the saints of the Most High. So, chapter 7 as a whole, we see that he's having this vision, these four different beasts that he can see, that he's trying to write down and understand what it represents is happening in the earth. But that the kingdom of God will rise up and it will take over, and it will also, it keeps on repeating that it will last forever. And so he's saying, hey, what does all of this mean? And so they say, these are four kingdoms. These are four kingdoms that will kind of rise up. And then the fourth beast represents one kingdom that will rise up, and it's kind of spread into 10 different ones. But then there's this one specific one, the little horn, that actually is able to take over three other kings by himself and become the greatest and biggest one. And then it wars against God. It does not like God. It wars against the saints. It changes calendars or times, and it changes laws. And so, very strange vision that he's having. So I've been looking up different commentaries, different scholars, reading different things, and it's very wild kind of what the differences in all of these kingdoms mean. And honestly, the fourth beast, it seems, has a divergent in some ideas. So let's get into it, okay? The first beast was like a lion with eagle's wings. This vision had some parallels to Nebuchadnezzar's dream in the first very dream that he had. So a lot of people, a lot of commentaries seem like the lion actually represented King Nebuchadnezzar himself. And you know how, like, when the wings were plucked off? It kind of represented when God was humbling King Nebuchadnezzar, that he was the lion, he was the king of all the animals. And we believe that, you know, how the lion is the king of all the animals on the earth, and the eagle kind of more represents the kings of the birds of the air and stuff. And so we see that the lion probably represented King Nebuchadnezzar. And when the wings were plucked is when God was humbling himself. Remember when he went crazy in the last few chapters, and then his reason came back to him, and all of a sudden, after his reason came back to him, he actually kind of, it seems like he has this repentant heart almost. I'm not sure fully, but it seems like there's something that really happened to King Nebuchadnezzar. And he said, you know, God is able to humble anyone. You know, God is actually most high. And so we see this change in Nebuchadnezzar. But from the dreams that Daniel interpreted, we know that Babylon represented the first part of it, and then next was the Medo-Persian Empire, and then the Grecian Empire, then the Roman Empire. And so we go on to the beast number two. It seems like the beast, it says, was like a bear, and then that would have been the Medo-Persian Empire as we know it. And it was raised up on one side, which is interesting. So raised up, I guess, kind of like, you know, lifted up, kind of his shoulders were bent, the animals were bent. But it probably meant, it talked about the unequal power between the Medos and the Persians. Okay, the Medes and the Persians were kind of two kingdoms almost in one. But we do know that the Persians were actually a little bit stronger than the Medes. Okay, they had this power imbalance in them. And so raised up on one side probably represented that in a way. And then it said that it had three ribs in its mouth. And we know that these could have probably meant the three kingdoms that Medo-Persian Empire conquered. We know they conquered the Babylonian Empire, they conquered Lydia, and they conquered Egypt. And so this three ribs could have represented the three different kingdoms that it had already devoured, okay? You see, God is trying to show us things that are happening, but he's showing them not necessarily every single thing, apocalyptic future. He's showing things that are naturally going to happen that he's already shown Daniel, but he's going to get, you see, God is showing him more in-depth reasoning, okay? He's showing him even that little details that he didn't show to King Nebuchadnezzar, but God is showing to Daniel so that Daniel can know these things and write them down as well. So we have the first thing is, you know, the lion as Babylon, the Nebuchadnezzar himself, plucking the wings. He can no longer fly. He can't go anywhere he wants. He's humbled all of a sudden. And then this bear representing Medo-Persia most likely, and the ribs is the three kingdoms. So what's the third beast? The third beast, it says, was like a leopard. And we know, and looking through culture, looking at history, also leopards are always considered to be very fast. And we know the cheetah's fastest, but leopards were always represented as something to being fast. And then, so having speed. And on top of that, we see that it has wings also, that represents even more speed. Now, what was the third kingdom that took over? We have Babylon, which was the head of that statue, you remember? We have Medo-Persian Empire, which was the middle section. And the bottom section was Greece and Alexander the Great. And what did Alexander the Great do more than any other person? He conquered the known world faster than any human ever, okay? His empire expanded so quick and so fast. It's one of the main things that made him Alexander the Great. Because he was able to take this over, it said, by his age of 32. 32, he had conquered the known world. Not like a little bit, not like a town, the entire known world by 32. That was a crazy guy. That's why he was named Alexander the Great as well. But we see this parallel of his speed and the speed at which the kingdom was able to progress. And so, by that, we know that Alexander the Great conquered faster than anyone, but there's a key in there. It says there's four heads on this leopard. So the leopard had four heads and a bunch of wings. I mean, obviously, Daniel was alarmed for probably pretty good reasons. And so the four kingdoms, the four heads, though, also could represent the four generals that Alexander the Great's kingdom was divided into. We know through history he was divided into four of his generals. And then they took over, and one was known as Macedonia at that point, and then another Egypt, another Syria, and another Thrace. And so The four heads could have represented those generals and those kind of four different kingdoms that arose after Alexander the Great died and was divided up against them. Now, all that being said, the fourth beast is very different, remember? It was terrifying. It didn't give a lot of animal kind of similarities. It was given the idea of iron teeth and horns and different... and it was just, it was vicious and it was terrifying, really. And so what do we know as the fourth kingdom that was already told to Daniel in the interpretation? We know it represented Rome in some way, okay? So it has to represent Rome in some way, but let's go into more detail. The beast had a lot of different interpretations that honestly I could find. I read three different commentaries and all of them kind of had the same idea, but slight variances. So we'll talk about that a little bit. But we know that it has to represent Rome in some kind of manner. But it also, there's some forms that starts off, or it says there's one horn that starts off little. Okay, remember the 10 horns on top of the beast's head or down its back or something. And we say there's a little horn, and it starts off little, but grows to take over three other horns, okay? Many commentaries say that there are still, we're actually still kind of in a Roman Empire. Now, this is a stretch, okay? This is commentaries. This is kind of just some of the study I was able to do. But a few of them say we're kind of in still a Roman Empire, okay? The Roman Empire is technically still kind of hanging on, but there's many sections to it. Now, we may not look like, you know, Europe, different African countries. Like, we all look like there's hundreds of empires, but it seems like the Roman Empire is still established in various different ways. And a lot of commentaries said that the 10 kingdoms could be 10 of the biggest established versions of the Roman Empire. The animal as a whole represented Rome as, you know, Babylon, the Medo-Persian, the Greece, and then Rome. But the 10 horns represented the 10 different distinctions that Rome still kind of has a hold on our earth, okay? And so you take that as you want, okay? But it says that, it kind of still seems like Rome. We're in Rome, just very different divergences. And the new Roman Empire looks very different, but with 10 different distinctions. And right now, the little horn is a lot like the beast we see in Revelation 13. Now, not to get too apocalyptic, because, you know, Daniel was, you know, in this time, and God was showing him things to come. But the little horn diverges from the beast itself, Rome representing itself. And it seems as though there's parallels between the beast in Revelation 13, okay? So take that as you want, but it seems like there is some kind of parallels to it. It also had 10 horns, and it also warred against God's people. It blasphemed God, and we see a lot of the same kind of similarities to it, okay? So the comparatives are very similar. But when it comes to blasphemy, you know, it speaks against God, wars against the state, it changes the tie, it changes laws and stuff. So we see that back and forth from Daniel and also Revelation 13. This gives us the possibility of the fourth beast representing the time from Jesus on. Now, does the little horn represent the Antichrist? I'm not sure, honestly. It could, it couldn't, but we definitely see that God is showing Daniel some things to come, and there is definitely similarities that we can't just overlook for no reason, okay? And so, but here's the big point, and this is where a lot of Christians lose themselves. We look at every single verse to know what's going to happen in the end times. Here's something, okay? The end times are going to happen the way God intends them, whether we know it or not, okay? Now, I do believe we should learn and we should be armed, but God always wants us to remember the very last thing that he keeps repeating in Daniel, something that the beast is not named. He doesn't name the beast. And so the name of the beast, knowing exactly who the Antichrist is not necessarily something that's very important in this situation, okay? We're going to know it when it happens, all right? God is going to reveal this stuff. He slowly reveals things all the time. And through Daniel, he didn't insist on telling us the name of exactly who this is. But he does go back a lot through Daniel, and we see this one specific line that the kingdom of God will be established and it will last forever. The saints will be victorious. We will conquer the world. God will take this world back from the evil one, and Jesus will sit enthroned forever and ever and ever for the end of eternity. That's what I want to leave you with today. No matter what happens, when we see these revelations, we see the plagues, if you're pre, mid, or post-tribulation rapture, look, whatever is going to happen is going to happen regardless of us. But Daniel is making a point several times through here. The kingdom of God will be established. His kingdom will rule forever and ever, and no one will be able to overthrow it. His dominion will last for eternity. It's amazing what God's going to do. So that's chapter 7. Very different from the rest of the books, but stay tuned. We'll get more into it. And in verse 28, like we started off with, Daniel was greatly alarmed. And it says he kept his heart in this matter. And just like Daniel, keep the word of God in your heart. Feel your mind, your soul, your spirit, your heart, whatever it is, whatever you feel like it's. Fill yourself up with the Word of God so much that nothing else can infiltrate it, okay? We have got to change our culture. And like Daniel, Daniel did not let the culture change him. He stood within the culture being an advocate for God and the Father. His kingdom will be established. Let's establish it. Let's do our part. Go ye therefore and make disciples. All right? Be blessed today.